Now let's take a look at the C4 profiles. So to create a sample C4 profile, you can just click execute the Rattle server with the hyphen sp option. And as you can see, it has saved that to a sampleprofile.conf file. Remember to remove the comments when you're going to actually use this profile. This is just a sample profile. That's the main reason. If I type more space sampleprofile.conf, this is how it would look like. So over here, what you have is a sample profile configuration. By default, the first is the admin list. So if you want to automate the execution of your server using a C4 profile, this is something that you must always have. If you don't have this, then whenever you start your server, it will give you an error that it cannot find the admin underscore list within your specific configuration file. This is your username and the password for your administrator. This can be very helpful when you want to automate the deployment of your command and control server to a specific server, or for DevOps-related activities where you want to automate the execution of several purple team activities. The next part is your C2 handler, which takes up the host colon port where your UI would connect, or the graphical user interface. The user list, if you want to add multiple users who can connect back to your server. You have a badges sample profile here, which clearly explains its information. Now, at any point of time, you should not be needing to create this. This is something that it's created on its own, and it is always saved within the logs directory that you would be having. Right now, there are no logs directory because I have cleaned up everything. But once a payload connects back, you would see a logs directory, and inside that, you will see a badger underscore token.conf, and you would see all this information. Now, the reason why this feature was added some time back was because initially, when I developed the command and control center, like maybe around 7 to 8 months back, the backend was not really that stable at that point of time. And I wanted to add a feature where, let's say, if for some XYZ reason the server crashes at that point of time, then all the configuration of the badger, including the token and the information, would always be stored in the server. Remember that this is just for getting a connection back for your badgers, because the badger will continuously try to connect back depending upon the sleep schedule, and it will try to send its token back, which would be simply this or something like this. And if your server doesn't have that in memory, because server, whenever you start a new server, it will only have the authentication key and not the cookie or the token, it won't be able to authenticate back to your payload, because the payload is sending a token, whereas your server is continuously expecting passwords which can create an initial authentication. In that case, you can simply specify the badger profile with the hyphen b command. Just specify the badger configuration file that is automatically created every time, and restore back all the cookies or the tokens from your existing badger connection. This is, however, something that you would never need in the current scenario, because it's extremely stable right now, and you would never have to worry about that. But this is something that was created a long time back, and I decided to just keep it because this could be something that would be may or may not be important at a later point of time. The next part are the credentials, which accepts an array. As you can see, this is a JSON array. And over here, in a JSON array, you have a specific JSON objects which accepts key colon value, and the key is basically the cred domain, cred node, cred pass, and the cred user. And these are the passwords. Whatever you type in this specific information over here, these would be added up in your graphical user interface whenever you start that up, which can be converted to your tokens for your Windows security tokens. You can also do that from the command line as well. This is just an option to create a graphical user interface. You have the utterance option. Whatever you type in here, and it will be loaded into the server. And whenever a payload connects back for the first time, they will quickly go ahead and take up whatever commands are there within this specific array or this list, and it will execute them and give you back a specific response. Whenever you want a specific set of, let's say, execution technique, let's say, for example, in-memory execution technique, maybe it could be memory allocation technique like virtual alloc, or let's something like NTRTL create user thread, or maybe file mapping technique, or anything else, you can add that up so that your payloads have this configuration, whatever you have specified. You can also configure what would be I would say, the kill date for your connection, so that whenever all of your payloads connect back, the commands, whatever are there in the alternate, would automatically be sent back, and you would get a set of responses. The next thing that we have is a click script, which can be used to automate a lot of your commands. It basically accepts any name over here for a click script. Over here, I have provided a MITRE name and a minimum set of information over here, which you can execute when you execute a specific click script. The next portion that we have are listeners. The listener simply takes in the name of the listener, the authentication count, that's basically the number of keys that you have, the authentication type, whether it's true or false. False basically means regular keys. True means one-time authentication keys. The C2 authentication keys in an array. Over here, you can add multiple keys if the count is more and if the odd type is true. The C2 URI that you have over here, you can add up multiple different URIs here. The extra headers that you would want when the payload connects back. The host over here, this is not your traditional host, this is your bind host. So this should be a valid IP address over here. Whether the creation of keys are random, if this is random, if the value is true, then it will automatically overwrite all the values that you specify over here in the C2 authentication keys part. It would read whatever authentication count that you have specified, and it will automatically create the number of keys that you specified over here and insert them into this C2 authentication keys array. Your OS type, which would be only Windows for the time being, the port, which would be 443 or whatever you want, the rotational host or domain fronting that you want over here, domain fronting name, the SQL, whether to enable or not, and the user agent over here that you would specify. The next part would be your payload configuration. The primary payload configuration or something like an HTTPS payload configuration over here, whenever the type is HTTP, you can specify something similar to your listener over here. This is what would be added to your payload profiler, and you can create different payloads depending upon the configuration or inject each of this configuration into memory and execute a new payload without dropping anything to disk. You have the SMB option here and the TCP, which can be used to move laterally, and all of these can be modified on the fly. You don't have to worry about that once you have added them over here, you won't be able to modify. There is no such thing in BruteTL. Everything is highly customizable and they can be modified on the fly by just modifying a simple value from the graphical user interface itself. The next thing that you have is the COM encryption key, your SSL keys, certificate path, and the next three important parts over here, which are the register DLL, register P, register object file, which basically is a feature where you could add your own in-house created payloads as an internal command of BruteTL. So what happens is that when you specify the path on the server with your DLL file over here, let's say in case of register DLL, it will go ahead and read that up and store that DLL into memory on the fly. Next time onwards, whenever you type box reflect, it would go ahead and show up the information over here that was specified. It would tell you that the architecture is x64, the description for this specific command or this specific payload that you have created on your own is specifically what you have specified over here. The number of arguments that it needs, whatever argument count you specify, if there's just one argument count, then it would directly execute. If there's two argument count, then it would simply print this screen unless you specify an argument to this specific command, which we'll take a look at later on when we delve deeper into the command executions from the terminal itself. That's from the Badger's terminal. The optional args, the minimum number of arguments, and to modify some specific strings if you want from the DLL before injecting it into a remote process, and so on. These should be the hex values. Remember that you can type it anything you want. You can also modify the date of the DLL when it was created by modifying the optional header. Or I think it's a P header. I don't exactly recall, but I believe it should be in the P header itself. You can modify that whatever you want over here by specifying those hex codes here. The next, similar to register DLL, you have register P where you can register a C# executable. You have a register OBJ file where you can register a specific object file which you can execute, and so on. And then you have the autosave configuration option, the PSExec option over here, and this can be modified directly from over here or from the graphical user interface as well. Right now, for the time being, what I will do is I have my own file that I have created, which I usually specify, send along with the release. In every release, you would see a C4 profile. So we would be using this over here. What exactly it does is that it adds a new user named as admin, and it keeps the auto save to false, adds auto runs, starts handler on 8443, a random encryption key, adds a specific two credentials to the credential manager. It has one listener option, payload configuration option for SMB and TCP. You can see that the URIs are pretty lengthy, long URIs over here. You have the PSEXEC configuration, the object file information, and similar more information that you have over here. We are loading up seedbuild and internal monolog as internal commands. We are using two sample object files, one in x86 as well as one in x64 format, which are your COF object files. And a simple DLL which just does nothing but simply prints a message box to screen. This is just to show that you can load your own reflective DLLs over here as an internal command as well. So I'll go back. I'll just close this portion. Close nevertheless. I'll close this as well. And I'll execute this rootetl/linux-c server c4 profile. And my bad, I'll have to specify -retl as well. And as you can see, it has restored three users, added two credentials, harvested ones, added two commands to auto run, one listener, three payload configuration, added these commands as internal commands and more. I can start my commander here. The password would be admin itself because that's what I kept in the C4 configuration. And you can see that we have a listener here. You can go to the creds, you can see the two credentials that we added. You can go to the WarMongoose site now. We have only one, but you should be able to connect back using the other users that we added. I don't exactly recall. As you can see, we have added a new WarMonger and simply would be able to connect back over here by going here and connecting back to either the brute, I believe that's the username and password. Yes, perfect. As you can see, we can connect back here. Similarly, you would be able to connect back to your other servers as well. And if I just maximize this, you would see the users here. The scratchpad would show the same configuration that you have. If you go to the auto runs part, you would see the auto runs have also been added here. So in this, and if you go to the payload profiler part as well, you would see three payload profiles. One is from this for the server itself, that's your listener. The remaining two are for your SMB payloads, where your SMB connection would listen on, that's basically the name pipe. And where your TCP listener will connect back. You can directly create your executables x64 or x86 from here, or your hex binary that's a blob executable DLL service or PowerShell file from over here itself and click it by selecting generate. Or now I have added this option here for because this is the only way to create an SMB and a TCP payload. Whereas if you want to create an HTTPS payload, you can just click on the name, click on generate, or you can just right click, go here and click on x86 or x64 payload. But remember that these are only HTTPS options. The SMB and TCP are pivot connections. They cannot directly connect back to your server. That's why there are no such options for your listener. They can only connect back to your badgers, which can connect to a specific TCP or an SMB connection that you have. So this is how you can write your C4 profiles, and that will be it for this video. In the next video, we will be taking a look at the by creating badgers and starting with the post-exploitation activities on the badger itself.